Well, turning your Bibles to Hebrews 11, we're continuing, of course, our study of the Hall of Fame of Faith. And in fact, that's really what we're looking at, is by faith, these men and women took God at His word. That's what we're seeing. And this is the key, because we want to do the same thing. We want to be men and women who trusted God, who trust God, who live our lives based on the word of God and by faith. And faith is a vital subject. I mentioned it earlier, that because our relationship and fellowship come by faith. Our relationship with Jesus, with God, comes through Jesus Christ. For by grace you've been saved through faith. We trust in Christ as our Savior, and we're saved forever, and we have an eternal relationship. But then our fellowship, our daily fellowship, comes by faith. It's a walk of faith, Colossians 2:6. As you've received Christ Jesus the Lord, we received Him by faith, so walk in Him. We see faith in action in Hebrews chapter 11. And this morning we're going to meet a famous man. And there's very little about him. In fact, we'll see just a little bit here. We'll go back to the place where he's mentioned in the Old Testament. And then, it may surprise you, but he's mentioned in the New Testament in another place. And we'll see it here in just a minute. He was a man who walked with God. What does it mean to walk with God? And what happened to him? We're calling this one the walk of faith. And so maybe we'll be encouraged to be men and women of faith as we see the Hall of Fame of Faith. Well, thinking about it, everybody loves to talk about prophecy, right? I mean, we all want to test end time events. And I remember one time when we did a study some years ago on the book of Revelation, and it was we did it on Sunday night. It was the biggest Sunday night crowd we ever had, because we said we're going to study Revelation, so everybody shows up. There is a lot of discussion and speculation concerning end time events. We did a study not too long ago in Sunday school called End Time Events. We put all the charts and the flow and everything up there. And you know, people always talk about, do you think we're living in the end times? Of course we're living in the end times. Hebrews chapter 11 actually says, anytime after Jesus, in fact, book of Hebrews in chapter 1 actually says, anytime after Jesus Christ came and died and rose again is the last days. We've been in the last days since Christ. What is the next event? What's supposed to happen next? Well, if you remember, we talked about the next event is Jesus is going to come in the clouds. We call it the rapture. The dead in Christ rise first. We who are alive and remain to be caught up together with Him and meet the Lord in the air. That's the next event. It could happen at any time. And 1 Corinthians says that we'll be gone and changed in a moment, in a twinkling of an eye. The word changed there means to be translated. Just changed from one place to another. This morning, we're going to look at a man who was translated. His name is Enoch, and it talked about he walked with God. And then it says that Enoch walked with God, and God took him. What? What do you mean, took him? We're going to see what happens, best we can tell from the Scripture. Everything is not all perfect and plain. He doesn't give a lot of information, but we'll look at it. So what is this all about? What is this man of faith? What does it mean, a man who walked with God? So we'll see it. As we continue, of course, we're thinking about the Hall of Fame of Faith, and we're seeing over and over those people who encourage us. And so let me remind you of some things we saw. We started off by faith, talking about faith and saying that faith is literally taking God at His word. That's what it is. And then we talked about four big truths of faith, is that faith always has an object. There's no such thing as a leap of faith. There's always something to believe. We trust in Jesus Christ Himself for eternal life. So faith always has an object. We said that the object of our faith is God's word. That's really the key, is that we believe the word of God. We said that it's not quality or quantity, quantity or quality of faith, but it's the object of our faith. You can say, I really believe in Buddha, but you're not going to be saved, because it doesn't matter how much you believe in Buddha. Buddha is not the Savior. It's the object of our faith which saves us, not the amount of faith. And then faith always pleases God. Those were the four things that we saw as we looked through this. Then we started going down to by faith. And the first one, we saw the creation by faith. The world was created by faith. God spoke all there is into being. He created everything from nothing by His word. We saw that in verse 3. It basically says we understand that the worlds were prepared by the word of God, the literal word of God. It's the Greek word, the word is rhema, which means an individual word. God spoke and He made the whole creation out of nothing. Then we saw, last time, I guess, we saw what was called the better, go to the next slide. We saw Abel offered a better sacrifice. We called it the sacrifice of faith. He came to God by faith, bringing a blood sacrifice. We know the story of Cain and Abel, and Cain brought a blood sacrifice, and Abel brought some fruit of the ground, and God had looked at with joy and basically approval on Abel's, but not with Cain's. And he basically, God said, you know what they're supposed to do. If you do what's right, you'll be okay. He was supposed to bring a blood sacrifice, because the blood sacrifice is the picture, the foreshadow of Jesus Christ. And we saw that, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. And we understand that through the Word of God, the only way to approach God, The only way you and I can approach God is through the blood sacrifice of Jesus Christ. He died on the cross. He paid for sin. He rose again. We trust in Him and Him alone to give us life. And we can come boldly unto the throne of grace because of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Today, we see what we're calling the walk of faith. And it's Enoch, the famous man. And we'll see it in verses 5 and 6. Let me kind of break it down for you. We call it the walk of faith. In verse 5, the first part, he's taken up by faith. What does that mean? He talks about that he was pleasing to God. And then we see in verse 6 that faith pleases God. If you said, well, I would hope God would be pleased with me, then live by faith. Take God at His word. Live out the truths and principles in our lives, and we'll see it. So let's start. Look at verse 5. Let me just read it. It says, by faith, Enoch was taken up so that he would not see death, and he was not found because God took him up, for he obtained the witness that before his being taken up, he was pleasing to God. You notice the verse starts in the same way as all the others, by faith. By faith. It's always that way. Enoch starts that way, and as you go through it, it's by faith Abel, by faith Enoch, by faith Noah, by faith Abraham, by faith Sarah. It's all the way through. And he says that by faith Enoch was taken up. The word taken up literally means translated. Translated. Now, if you said this is in Greek, in fact, our Bible, New Testament, was in Greek, and somebody translated it, changed it from Greek to English, we say that was translated. We can be translated. Enoch was translated. He was changed from being on the earth in a body like that and being taken up to be with God. And so when this passage says, by faith Enoch was taken up, literally it says he was translated. It's the same word used in 1 Corinthians 15:51. It says, we'll not all sleep, but we'll all be changed, translated. There's going to come a time when Jesus Christ is going to come, and every one of us in this room who know Christ as Savior, when He comes in the clouds, you'll be changed just like that. In the moment, in the twinkling of an eye, if you've already died, your body will be raised and changed. If you're alive, you'll be changed just like that. Now, Enoch, it says here, that by faith, Enoch was translated so that he would not see death. He was not found because God took him up. God translated him. He obtained the witness before his being translated. He was pleasing to God. It says, by faith, Enoch was taken up. Why? So that he would not see death. He didn't experience death. He didn't die physically. You might say, well, what's the deal? Do you realize that there are only two people that we know about that didn't die physically in the scripture? One is Enoch, and the other is Elijah. You remember Elijah was walking along with Elisha, and he told Elisha said, I'd like to have your coat, and I'd like to have your power. And Elijah said, if you see me taken away, you'll have it. And all of a sudden, this chariot came out of the heavens and swooped down and picked up Elijah and took him away. And Elisha said, well, I saw it, so I guess I got all this. But he was taken away without dying physically, and Enoch was taken away without dying physically. One of the things that it didn't tell us, where were they taken to? You know? It says this, by faith, Enoch was taken up so that he would not see death. It goes on to say, and he was not found because God took him. It says he was not found. That literally has the idea, I think next slide says it, he disappeared. Do you realize that Enoch wasn't a guy who lived by himself? Enoch had a daddy. Enoch had sons, and they were all together. And all of a sudden, one day he's gone. And they can't find him. Notice it says, by faith, Enoch was taken up so that he could not see it. And he was not found. People started looking for him. They were going, has anybody seen Enoch? Anybody know what he got? They said, well, I heard he was walking with God. I don't know what happened to him, right? So he was not found. What a story. What happened to this man? A man who lived on the earth was translated never to die. People couldn't find him. Let's see what happened. Let's go back to Genesis chapter 5. Let's do that. Take your Bible, hold your place, and flip back to Genesis chapter 5. And I want you to see this chapter. And by the way, as we start Genesis chapter 5, this chapter is called the death chapter. That sounds good, right? Yeah, it's not really good. Because when you look at it in Genesis chapters 1 and 2, you have the creation. In chapter 3, you have the four and the fall. And in chapter 4, you have God's provision for mankind for salvation. And then in chapter 5, you see what's happened because of the fall. The wages of sin is what? Death. And that's why it's called the death chapter. Look at chapter 5, verse 1. It says, this is the book of the generations of Adam. And the same day that God created man, he made man in his likeness. He created him male and female. And then it talks about in verse 3, and Adam lived 130 years, and he became this and this and this. And then look at verse 5. So all the days of Adam were 930 years, and he what? He died. Look down at verse 8. So all the days of Seth were 912 years, and he died. Look down at verse 11. And all the days of Enosh was 905 years, and he died. And as you keep reading this passage, you're going to see over and over that everybody does what? They die. And if something doesn't change, every one of us in this room, what's going to happen to us? We're going to die. If Jesus doesn't come back and get us, all of us eventually are going to die, because the wages of sin is death. But we see something, and I want you to meet somebody. Verse 18, I want you to meet a guy by the name of Jared, okay? Verse 18, Jared lived 162 years. And by the way, let me just say this, just so you understand. When people see, you see all these years, and some people say, well, it couldn't be right. I mean, nobody can live 900 years. Nobody lives 800 years. Before the flood, if you notice, before the flood, this flood hadn't happened yet. Flood happens in chapter 6. Before the flood, people lived much longer than after the flood. In fact, before the flood, people lived 800 to 900 years. After the flood, the first generation lived 300 years and then began to go down from there. The best that we can understand is that the canopy that covered the earth before the flood, which basically knocked out the rays of the sun in a harmful way, people lived longer. After the flood, if you remember, the water came from up out of the ground and the water fell out of the sky, and that canopy, which was talked about in Genesis 1-2, is gone. And that's why, best we can tell, people don't live as long because of the environment of the world. So when you see that it says he was 162 years old and he had a child, don't think, well, Bible's just way off. No, it's not way off. The guy's 162 years old and he has a son. Now, here's what's amazing. It says Jared lived, listen, 800 years after he became the father of Enoch. This is Enoch's daddy and the other sons and daughters. So Jared was, listen how old this guy was, 962 years. Now that is the second oldest person in the Bible. So this man named Enoch's daddy was the second oldest person in the Bible. You know who the first oldest person in the Bible is? What's his name? Methuselah. Guess who he was? Watch. And Enoch lived 65 years and became the father of Methuselah. So this man named Enoch, his daddy was the second oldest man in the whole Bible, and his son was the oldest. So Enoch's father was the second oldest person, and his son was the oldest. And guess what? In this whole listing of how long people lived, Enoch lives the shortest. 365 years. You go, well, 365, I'll take 365, right? But not when everybody else is 962, right? You go, well, that's kind of a ripoff. But it's not a ripoff, because Enoch is going to what? Walk with God, and we'll see what happens. Notice, so Enoch lived, verse 21, Enoch lived 65 years and became the father of Methuselah. We're gonna talk about Methuselah a little bit more when we get to Noah, because see, Noah's next in the list, and it says, by faith Noah built an ark, basically. We're going to talk about what Methuselah's name means and how it ties in to Noah, and how he is the oldest person who lived in the scripture, and how it fits. It says that Enoch walked with Enoch lived 65 years and became the father of Methuselah. Then Enoch walked with God 300 years after he became the father of Methuselah, and he had other sons and daughters. Now, why don't you to notice what it says? He walked with God. What does this mean? It has an idea of a fellowship. It has an idea of a close fellowship. It has an idea of step by step. Enoch was close to God. Enoch was one of those people that he somehow he spent time with God. He wanted to know God. He wanted to be close to him. And it says he walked with God. And then it says all the days of Enoch were 365 years. We go, wow, that's good. And then Enoch walked with God, and he was not. It doesn't say Enoch died. Everybody in the list, they died, they died, they died, they died, they died. Till you come to Enoch and it says, Enoch was not. And then it says why? For God took him. The book of Hebrews tells us that he was going along and God translated him so that he would not see death. So this walk, there's only one other person in the Bible who said that they walked with God. And guess who that was? That's Noah. That's the next guy. He lived 300 years. and walking with God. And how does a person walk with God? Colossians 2:6, as you've received Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk ye in him. You received him by what? By faith. So if you're going to walk with God, you're going to walk by faith. So he lived 365 years, and then it says he was not. His son is the oldest man who ever lived. His father was the second oldest person who ever lived. And it says, and Enoch walked with God, and he was not, for God took him. The word Hebrew there is translated. God translated him. In Hebrews 11:5, when it says he was taken up, it's translated. Now, we all look at that and go, isn't that amazing? Like, oh, here's all these people that were going along, and they died, and they died, and they died, and that. And we look at today, and we see people die all the time. And how many people do you know didn't die, but they just disappeared off the face of the earth? We say, well, nobody that we know of. At this time, there was this man named Enoch. And he walked with God. Now, there's something about him you may not know. And I want you to turn to the book of Jude. Now, that is, go all the way to the back of the Bible, to the book of Revelation. Come back one book, okay? So get to Revelation. If you get to Revelation, you've gone a little too far. But just go to the back and then come back to the book right in front of it, which is the book of Jude. By the way, Jude was Jesus' half-brother and wrote this book. And it's about contending for the faith and about dealing with false teachers and those kind of things. He actually mentions Enoch. Did you know that Enoch wrote some things down? Did you know that this man Enoch, who walked with God for over 300 years, 365 years he lived on the earth and disappeared off the face of the earth, did you know he was a prophet of God? What does a prophet do? They give what? Revelation. They give information from God. Look at verse 14. It was about these men that Enoch, in the seventh generation from Adam, prophesied. So let's stop for just a second. Verse 14 there is, a prophet is one who gets direct revelation from God. He's quoting it. Was there a slide right before that? Yeah, well, no, okay, that's good. Go ahead, because this is where Jude is quoting from Enoch. And notice what he's called. It was about these men that Enoch, the seventh generation from Adam. If you go back to the book of Genesis, you go from Adam, and you go to his son, and you go down, and you go down. The seventh generation from Adam was Enoch. And his dad was 962 years, and his son was 969, and he was 365. But it says he was a prophet. He was a prophet. It was about these men. What men? Well, if you stop and you take the time to go back the verses, and we're not going to take that time, but in the book of Jude, Jude writes to say, he said, first of all, I had planned to talk about living and standing for the truth. And then he said, but I thought I better warn you about false teachers. And he warns about false teachers. And that's why when you get to verse 14, it says it was about these men, false teachers, that Enoch, in the seventh generation from Adam, prophesied, saying, behold, the Lord comes with many thousands of his holy ones to execute judgment upon all, and to convict all the ungodly of their ungodly deeds, which they have done in an ungodly way, and of all the harsh things which ungodly sinners have spoken against him. I think the word that stands out there is ungodly, right? Enoch prophesied about Jesus coming with an army. When did that happen? It hasn't happened. Exactly right. Enoch, who lived all those years ago and was taken off the face of the earth, while he was still on the earth, while he walked with God, he wrote some things down. There's a book called the Book of Enoch that has this information. Jude is quoting it. And he says, Enoch told about the time that Jesus is coming, that God is coming with an army, and he's going to execute judgment. Notice what it says, the Lord comes with many thousands of his holy ones. Who are the holy ones? Well, you're exactly right. A lot of people, when they look at that and it says holy ones, they first assume angels. But when Jesus comes the second time as the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, to execute judgment, he's coming with who? With us. We're the holy ones. I want you to see something. I think I've got it right here. I think we have a chart. Do we have the chart? Yes. All right. this is, of course, the Old Testament, and this is the prophecies, and here's Jesus coming and dying on the cross and paying for sin. That's called the first coming of Jesus Christ. After Jesus died and rose again, he ascended into heaven. 40 days later, the Holy Spirit came down, and we're in the church age. Jesus is going to come in the clouds, called the rapture. That's when we'll be translated. That's what happened to Enoch. He was translated and taken off the face of earth. That's not the second coming of Christ. This is the first coming of Christ. This is the coming in the clouds. Jesus doesn't come to the earth. We meet him in the air. Following that, there will be a time period on the earth called the tribulation, and then Jesus comes as the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, and he comes to the earth to set up a kingdom. This is what Jude prophesied. He says the Lord is going to come with thousands of his holy ones to execute judgment upon all. When Jesus Christ comes as the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, he's going to set up the kingdom. And Matthew 24 and 25 says there'll be a judgment of sheep and goat. The sheep of the believers, the goats of the unbelievers. The unbelievers will be cast away. The believers will go into the kingdom. Jude prophesied all those years ago that one day the Lord would come with thousands, many thousands of his holy ones. And that is us. If you want to look at it, the Bible, it's Revelation 19, beginning at verse 11, as the heavens open and Jesus Christ comes riding on the white horse, and we are coming with him, and he comes to bring judgment upon the earth and set up his kingdom to rule in righteousness and judgment. This man, Enoch, who walked with God, prophesies that one day the Lord would come and judge the world. That's what he's talking about there. So, Enoch was a prophet of God. I want you to turn back to Hebrews 11. So, by verse 5, Hebrews 11, verse 5, it says, by faith Enoch was taken up, translated, so he wouldn't see death, so he would never die physically. He wasn't found. People looked for him. They disappeared because God translated him, took him up. For he obtained, watch, the witness that before his being taken up, he was the man. Before God took him off the face of the earth, he was pleasing to God. He was pleasing to God. J. Vernon McGee tells a story. He said he was teaching children one time, and all these little children there, and he wanted to explain to them about Enoch walking with God. He said, well, there was a man named Enoch, and almost every day he would go out and he would walk with God, and they would walk and talk. And then he would say, I'll see you, God, and he would go back home. But one day Enoch was talking with God, and they walked and walked and walked, and God said to Enoch, I think you're closer to my house than your house. Why don't you just come home with me? And so Enoch went with God. By faith, Enoch was taken off the face of the earth. He would not see physical death. He was not discovered or found. Why? Because God took him up, and he was pleasing. Now let me ask you something. How do you please God? How do you please God? This verse goes on to tell us. Notice verse 6. And without faith, it's what? It's impossible to please him. For he who comes to God must believe that he is, and that he is the rewarder of those who seek him. How do we please God? Without faith, it's impossible to please God. The hall of fame of faith is people who please God. Verse 2 says, by faith, men of old gained approval. Verse 6 says, without faith, it's impossible to please God. Do you and I want to please God? What do we do? We live by faith. We live by the word of God. We walk with God. We can walk with God. The Bible says, walk in the Spirit. The Holy Spirit's God, isn't he? Walk in the Spirit and you'll not fulfill the lust of the flesh. We can walk worthy of the calling. This passage says that he had this testimony before being taken up that he was pleasing to God. Do we want to be pleasing? We need to do this. A walk of faith is one in which we live by the word of God, which is pleasing him. How do we do that? Well, I want you to think about this. Ephesians 4:1 says, walk worthy of the calling which we've been called. Colossians 2:6 says, as we receive Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk ye in him. So we can have a worthy walk, a walk of faith. And here's how you do it. And Ephesians tells us this in Ephesians 5. He says, walk in love and walk in light and walk in wisdom. Walk in love is loving God and loving others. You want to be pleasing to God? You wake up in the morning and you say, God, I just want to love you and I want to love other people. I want to live in such a way that your love shines through me to touch lives for Jesus Christ. Love is action. Love is not a feeling. Love has feelings with it, but love is an action. So walk in love. The second one is walk in light. That means holiness and righteousness. We live in a fallen world that is dark. We're to be lights in the midst of a crooked and perverse generation. We're to shine as lights in this world. And so we walk in light and purity. And then the third thing is we walk in wisdom. Wisdom is application of truth. When we see the truths of the Bible and we apply them in our lives, that is wisdom. Enoch was a man who walked with God, who was pleasing to God. And he had a testimony that he was pleasing to God. We can do the same thing. We can walk worthy of the calling. We can walk by faith. We can walk in love. We can walk in light. We can walk in wisdom. So when we wake up in the morning and we say, God, I want my life to count for you. I want to love you. I want to love them. I want to live in such a way that you get all the honor and glory. I want to touch lives for Jesus Christ. I want to live wisely based on the word of God. Now notice what he goes on to say in verse 6. He says, without faith, it's impossible to please him. You can't please God unless you live by faith. For he who comes to God, if you're going to come to God, here's what, you must believe that he is and that he is a rewarder of those who seek him. He's not talking about eternal life salvation when he says that you must believe that he is and that he's a rewarder of those who seek him. He's talking about you seeking him in this Christian life, that you live for him, because he rewards you. When you live righteously and godly, when you walk by faith, what will he do for you? He will reward you. Notice what it says. He is a rewarder of those who seek him. One day, when you stand before him, and what if he says, well done, good and faithful servant. You lived by faith. He says, take this that is prepared for you. He rewards us. We know that in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 10, he says, we shall all stand before the rewarding seat of Christ to be rewarded for the things that we've done in this body, whether good or worthless. When you stand before Christ, having lived a life of faith, you'll be like Enoch, who was pleasing to God. And we can be like Enoch and we can say, well done. I am pleased, you faithful servant of Christ. So we walk in what? Believe that he exists. We walk in love. We walk in light. And we walk in wisdom. We walk in love, doing something for others as we live for Christ. We walk in holiness, knowing and applying the Bible. We walk in wisdom, living for the eternal. So what can we apply? Well, simply put, let's walk by faith like Enoch. Let's do it. Let's please God. There's three things as you walk by faith that we see in our scripture is walk in love, walk in light, and walk in wisdom. Love God and others, live holy and righteously, and live according to scripture. I'm sorry, stay back on that one if you would. There we go. Walk in love, walk in light, walk in wisdom. That's what we're supposed to do. Let's walk by faith. Because when you stand before Christ, there are two things that can happen. According to 1 John chapter 2, it says we could be ashamed at his coming. So when you're translated and you stand before him at what's called the judgment seat of Christ, the rewarding stand, and if we haven't lived by faith, we're going to be ashamed. We have eternal life. We're going to be with Jesus Christ forever. That's not the issue. The issue is rewards. And so either you're going to be ashamed at his coming, or we might hear him say, well done, good and faithful servant. You lived by faith like Abel. You lived by faith like Noah. You lived by faith like Enoch. You lived by faith like Abraham. You lived by faith like Sarah. You lived by faith like Moses' mom and daddy. You lived by faith like Moses did. Every one of us can do that. Second, realize that we could be the generation that is translated. Could Jesus Christ come back any second? He could, any second. There's no signs. People talk about, oh, there's a lot of signs. There's no signs, not for the rapture. There's all kinds of signs for the second coming. There are no signs for the rapture. Could happen any second. Jesus Christ could come in the clouds, and the dead in Christ rise first. We heard a lot of man be taken away just like that. We could be the generation. So if it could happen in any second, how should we be living? By faith. So that when we're raptured out and we're standing there, he says, well done, good and faithful servant. May we walk by faith, pleasing God, looking for the blessed hope and the appearing of our Savior.